engineers.
Six operations.
Yeah. All on my back.
Close to death.
Been in rehab twice. Three times. And they come out and tell my wife on a regular occasion that I was dying. And I think actually I came near death twice. Is that right, baby? She has to tell most of them because they kept me so drugged up I didn't know I was in the world. You know, but God is so faithful.
Hallelujah.
I mean, in the hands of, I don't want to be ugly, but my wife's looking at me and saying, don't be ugly.
Don't be ugly, Ryan.
Okay. I just need to speak through, so. But anyhow, four bad operations that wound me up near death, and pretty bad experience. Pretty bad.
But God
laid a doctor from Emory in my lap. I had seen an Emory doctor, Dr. Munford, for pain and management, and they and he took a copy of the X-ray that we had, and he says, "I know one person that needs to see you." And I said, "Who's that?" And he said, "Dr. Michael, Keith Michael." He's got three first names, I kid you about it. It's Keith, Walter, Michael. I said, "Well, you ought to ask for something." He said, "I know they're telling you that you're dying." I said, "Yeah." And he said, "You are." But he said, "I'm not going to let that happen." He said, but they replaced some bones and put rods and replaced some things on my spine, and a couple places on my spine, put some clamps and screws and what have you, and straightened out a backbone, untied my sciatic nerve that was causing me to be in a wheelchair and not be able to walk, and the other group of doctors were telling me I was probably never going to walk again. And,
thank you, Jesus.
But Dr. Michaels told me, he said, "That's not true."
Yes.
He said, "You're going to walk again." He said, "You're not walking. He said, "You're not walking because you can't walk." He said, "You can't walk because your sciatic nerve is in a ball up against your spine." And that's what I went into the hospital for. And they did four surgeries on me, and the doctor at Emory told me that he don't even see what they done. And a lot of infection, a lot of things I won't go into, but he said the worst kind of infection you can have in your body. He said I had it. And I was on antibiotics for over 2 months. And but God.
forgiveness is a blessing.
Yes. Yes, it is.
And if you are a giver, you know it's a blessing. Yes. If you're not, you don't know nothing about it. So Rick, Elder Piper, would you come? And he has a little demonstration for us, and then we're going to move on into the Word.
A little demonstration on tithing. Psalms 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. So everything belongs to God. You see the table that says God? And ours, everything belongs to God. So there's various items on here, pillows, paper towel, 10 of each, 10 rolls of toilet paper, 10 books, water, some soda, potato chip, even some cupcakes, magazines, even $10. So, but there's another little scripture, St. John 3:27. And John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except to be given him from heaven. The government may shut down, but I have to thank God that government has not shut down. Look at St. John 3:27 when you have a chance, that a man can receive nothing. So material and natural blessings all come from God. I'm going to need somebody to help me right quick. Would you come, ma'am? Your mom told me your name, but I don't want to mess it up.
Malaysia.
Yes, ma'am. Malaysia. Would you come? Your brother here? Yeah. Would you guys come? Because everything on this team, God's going to bless us. Okay? So I need y'all to help me.
I'm not going to try to twist your arm. manipulate you or make you feel bad or anything like that. If the word don't convince you, you're just not convinced. That's it. See, because you can't see God. I can't see God. We can only see how he manifests himself. And I told you last week when I cut off, I said, you know, a lot of people say, well, that's just a coincidence. And I told you, if all what God's been doing in my life is just a coincidence, I hope you just keep on. I just keep on having all these coincidences. Because they're mighty good to me. And mighty good. So people don't like, turn to 1 John because of the third John. That's what we're headed. Eddie, just take it out a little bit. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Third John. People don't like to talk about money until they need it.
That's it.
Uh-huh. And people, when they need it, they want to talk about it all the time.
That's it.
Huh? Yeah, you see, because the truth is, money will answer not all our problems, but most of our problems. They'll answer a lot of health problems that, I'm not saying that God don't divine heal, but you need some medical insurance. It takes money to buy it, don't you?
Yes.
You need food, don't you?
Yes.
It takes money to buy it, don't you?
Yes.
If you are living in Atlanta and trying to get to work, most of the time you need an automobile or at least a bus pass, don't you?
Uh-huh.
It takes money for that, don't you? You need clothes, don't you? Huh? No, I'm just. So most of the things that we deal with every day, it takes money. And so you have to ask yourself, because if God said we should give it and be liberal about it, not just giving to the church, but giving to one another, and we don't, then you have to ask yourself, am I really flowing in all that God has for me? And then if you like the results you're getting, the way you're living, and what you're doing, I invite you to keep on doing. Yeah, I ain't gonna fuss with you. But I believe the Spirit of the living God told me to teach this, and I believe he told me because somebody wants something different. Mm-hmm. And that's who I came for, whoever it was, whoever that may be, that wants something different. You got your Bibles, 3 John?
Yes.
Okay. First and second verse, the elders unto the well-beloved Geshe, whom I love in the truth. Beloved, say it.
Beloved.
I wish above all things.
I wish above all things.
That thou mayest prosper.
That thou mayest prosper.
And be in health.
And be in health.
Even as thy soul prospers.
Even as thy soul prospers.
And we said our soul was our mind, our will, our emotions. And so if we get our mind together, get our emotions in check, and submit our will to God, then our soul should be prospering, shouldn't it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And if our soul is prospering, then God says he wants us to prosper and be in health, didn't he?
Yes.
It was not the will of God that I was sick. It was not the will of God that Roger went through all that pain. And whether you're sick, that's not the will of God. We're under this cursed earth, and everything is falling under here. Anything can happen to you.
Yes.
But that ain't God's best. He showed us his best when he finished. He said everything that he did, it was good.
Yes.
And then man got involved, and it got bad.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of things that's happening down here, but you need to have something that can counteract that. And God gave us a plan.
Yes.
Because you can't trust financial systems.
No.
They'll fail you.
Oh, yes.
You can't trust I was reading, go ahead and be seated. I was reading this week, and it said, I don't know how many saw it, it was talking about a particular bank, and that all of these accounts, these people were going to the ATMs, and they were going to withdraw money, and they were paying bills and stuff, and they had all these insufficient funds come back and all of these different things, and there had been a giant glitch, they said, with this bank. And these people were frustrated. They were all calling in, and everybody was calling customer service. They had overloaded their lines and everything because they thought they had money in the bank. And so, but what they found out, just one glitch can wipe out everything you got. And then what? We dealt with Sam Club last week, where how people went to work and they didn't have a job. That's painful. And I don't want to belittle any of that, but that's painful when you wake up because you made plans. We people are, you know, we make plans. We plan that somebody probably bought a house. Somebody probably bought a car. Somebody probably ran up some bills for Christmas because they figured they would pay them off by next year, right? And so then they walk to a job unexpectedly and the door slammed in your face. That can be trauma. That can be devastating because you got a family to feed possibly, or yourself to feed, other things to take care of. And so if you don't have no other source than that job, you're in trouble. I say you're in trouble. But thank God there is a God. I say thank God there is a God. That even when all of the gods are against us, he can do something about it. And see, what's wonderful about God is that when you've been faithful to him, he's always faithful to you.
Yeah.
The Bible says he's not unrighteous to forget your labor of love and that you do minister to the saints and do minister. See, God don't forget. Man may forget you. You may do something for man, kind of a person, and they may forget like you've never done anything for them. But when you do something in the name of the Lord, he's faithful. And so we looked at Proverbs, and we're not going back to there, we're just going to keep traveling. But he said, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. And that's why a lot of us get in trouble. When we get in a situation, we start leaning to what we understand. We don't lean to God, we lean to our understanding. And when we lean to our understanding, it's not that we become bad people, it's just that now our trust is not in God, it's in our understanding, how I look at this situation. I've been there. And it's like being between a rock and a hard place, and you have to make a decision. Am I going to trust God, or am I going to trust myself? And I've had to make that decision a few times where I said, I'm going to trust you, Lord, because if your word is true, then I got to find out. And we're going to look at that. But see, the only way you find out whether God is really true and that he won't lie to you is that you trust him. And so when you go back to the book of Genesis, we looked at when Abraham, and we said before anything was established, any law, anything else, Abraham gave tithes, didn't he? We said, I established that last week. Abraham gave tithes. And see, he gave it out of the goodness because what Ellen Pfeiffer just brought forth in his demonstration, he realized the earth of the Lord and the fullness thereof, that if all this belongs to God, and all he's asking for is 10%, that Abraham was so grateful how God had blessed him, he gave it willingly.
Yes.
You see, let me say something to you to help you help you before your little mind in the ground. God don't need your money. God will survive and will survive you before you ever came along. And see, I learned a long time ago. I've been passing off for 30, I've been almost 36 years. I learned a long time ago that there's no way I'm going to put my trust in people. There is no way that I'm going to be running around here wondering whether you're going to give 10% and put my trust in determine how I'm going to live. I just won't do it. No, I just won't do it. If you do it, fine. If you don't, but I've learned that when I put my trust in God, that God always supplies abundantly above all that I ask or think. He always asks in every situation. And so you need to understand God ain't depending on you. God is trying to get something to you, not trying to take something from you. Because he's going to be God whether you ever give it or not. His plans, his principles, they going to work whether you ever work them or not. Mm-hmm. And so God is not trying to pull. See, if you don't do it cheerfully, God don't want it anyway. I'm going to show you that in a moment. Whatever cheerful heart. It has to be with a grateful heart. It has to be with a thankful heart. And so you need to make up in your mind, if you're going to be a tither, you can't be a complaining tither. No, I said you can't be a complaining tither. If you're going to do it, don't do it grumbling and complaining. You might as well do it. I'm serious. If you're going to murmur and complain, Lord,
quiet.
Well, Abraham was a tither, but his son and his grandson was. And we're going to look at his grandson, Jacob, for a moment. Then turn over to Genesis 28. Mm-hmm. Genesis 28, the 20th verse, through the 22nd. You have it? Genesis 28 and 20, you got it? I said, do you have it?
Yeah.
All right, let's look. Now Jacob's on the run. And his life ain't really what you call is in order right now. He really ain't got a bunch of money. He's running to a relative. He's trying to get things together in his life. And this is where the setting is. Let's look. And Jacob vowed a vow, saying, if God will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go, that I will give and will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on. Look what he's asking for. So you know he's in the kind of dire place, don't you? He said, now God will give me bread. Look what he says. Now he vowed that, didn't he? And Jacob vowed that. So that I come again to my father's house in peace. Then shall the Lord do what?
Be my God.
Now look at him. He saw the guy. He said, God, if you'll show me that you'll take care of me and provide for me, then I'll serve you. But he didn't stop there. Look what he says. And this stone which I have set for a pillar shall be God's what? And all that thou shalt give me, I will what?
Surely.
Do what?
Yeah.
Okay, let's do it again. And of all that thou shalt give me. Did you keep it? The Bible says it's better not to make one if you're going to make one and not keep it. Are you with me? He said, and this stone which I have set for a pillar shall be God, shall be what? And see, the church ain't established yet, but he got established in his heart. He said, this that I set here, memorial, he said, this is going to be God's house for me. And look what he said. And of all that thou shalt give me, he understood where it was coming from. He understood it was not his hard work and all that. Yes, you must work in you. It was not his gifts and his talents and all the things that he was going to do. He understood that it was not him. He understood that God was the giver. He said, and of all that thou shalt give me, I will surely give a tenth unto thee. See, if your heart, see, Jacob understood, look, I'm in a bad condition. He said, if God began to bless me, see, and that's our problem sometimes. When we're in a bad condition, we say all types of things to God. Yeah, God, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. I have seen people make all types. Lord, if you open up this door, Lord, how you going to give God? Feel like, you know, y'all be all into the lottery and stuff. And you, if you won $400 million, people. And I'm just going to be real with you. Say, Pastor, I'm going to keep it real. I'm going to keep it real with you. I'm going to be real with you.
100.
See, God, I know what teaching does sometimes. When you first hear it, you get motivated out sometimes. When you want to really get out of a situation, or, you know, it's like with anything, you know, New Year's, you want to lose weight, you get motivated, don't you?
Yeah.
But see, then the grind comes. Say grind.
Grind.
See, because after January, there's February, and then there's March. And so if you're going to stick with this particular weight loss program, or whatever you're trying to do, see, all types of temptations going to come and say, well, because see, in January, what did you say to yourself? You said, I ain't eating this, I ain't eating that, I'm giving up this, I'm giving up that, but in February, you know, you start making little excuses for yourself. Well, I did say, maybe I don't need to give up ice cream. Maybe what I need to do is just have a scoop a week, or, you know, something. See, what you're starting to do, see, you're breaking down. So what you want to tell yourself now is, give yourself an excuse to have this.
Come on now.
and weeds come up everywhere, and you know, I dig this one out, spray this one, spray it, then finally, I got some sense, and I got somebody come out there and spray, and they come out there every other month and spray, and keep the weed, just to keep the weed from coming back up.
Yeah. That's it.
Some of you all, when some to rejoice in other people's seasons. I mean, really rejoice. I mean, really get excited. Yeah. They did everything that is on my wish list. They testified about it. But I learned to rejoice with them. Because God has been doing it for them, that means I'm next in line somewhere. Because you're going to be tried. You're going to be tested. Look at Malachi, the third chapter, you got it? Mm-hmm. Look what it says. Will a man rob God? Now, that scripture has always been so troubling to me. Because God owns everything, doesn't he? And him owning everything. See, and it wasn't the word, it was the word that he used. He said rock. He didn't say steal. Because usually when you rob somebody, you're facing them. You're looking at them. You're taking in their face. He didn't say, will a man steal from God?
Sneak.
He said, will a man rob God? Then that means you have the unmitigated gall and the audacity to look God in the face and say, no, I ain't giving it to you. It's yours, but I'm not giving it to you. Then man up. Be a man or woman about it. And say, God, I'm proud of you. See, we don't like that sound. But say it. Man up. Be a woman about it. Be a man about it. Take ownership of it. Be responsible. He said, will a man rob God? Yet ye rob me. But he said, ye ask, or ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? He said, ye asking, now I'm asking you. He said, you rob me in your tithes and in your offering. Let me move on. Ninth verse. He said, you're a curse with a curse. For you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Now, see, God ain't cursing you. You're cursing yourself. God ain't saying, no. You're going against godly principles, and so they're already set in motion. So either you flow with them or you go against them. If you flow with them, they bless you. If you go against them, they curse you. Okay, you can see this, can't you? You said in the classroom, here's a test. The teacher give you the test. They've given you instructions on what to study and all that, right? Huh? You know the test coming, right? They've told you what you should study, right? And you get a big fat F because you didn't prepare yourself, didn't study, didn't do what you're supposed to. Who fault is it? Who fault is it? Who brought the F on? Who called himself to fail that grade? Who? Uh-huh. You did. what you need to do, right? So this is what God said. When you don't do what you're supposed to do, when I have instructed you what to do, then you curse yourself. Now, let me ask you this. How can a cursed person be blessed? How can God really bless your finances up there in the curse? Ask yourself that. Not I just say it. Don't let the marrow stone act this way now. He said, you curse yourself. Now, if you curse yourself, let me ask you this. If you curse yourself by not tithing, can you pray yourself, pray the curse off?
Law and motion.
Huh?
Law and motion.
What'd you say? Say?
It's a law in motion.
So, you can be crying out to God, very personal,
yes.
Believe me, and I have experienced it. But he ain't gonna always show mercy. He gonna let you go through some things, because you are willfully going against him. So, if you are under a curse, how do you expect your finances to be blessed? Huh? But see, this is what the devil will do to you. He'll always try to convince you not to do it because he knows it'll keep you under that curse.
That's good.
He'll keep telling you don't have enough, you can't make it, you don't do it. He'll keep telling you, and because he knows the word of God, he knows that will keep you at curse rating on your finances.
That's good.
Mm-hmm. He knows it. Now look what the 10th verse says. You have it. Bring you all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. Huh? And then what did he say? And do what? He says, if you do what you're supposed to do, then you can prove me. See if I'm alive. That's what he's saying. He said, if you do what you're supposed to do, what you can do is prove me and step out of life. See? And see, what you need to either become is living proof that you're under the blessing, or living proof that you're under the curse. Uh-huh. He says, prove me now, herewith saith the Lord of hosts. He says, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, he's not talking about a blessing. He's talking about you're under that blessing and it's flowing. Huh? And so he says, pour you out a blessing that there shall be what? Not room enough to do what? Uh-huh. See, God is like this. He won't ask you to do something and won't back up his word. He said, prove it. Well, if you don't believe me, I'm not asking you to believe me. Now, what I'm asking you to do is prove it. Don't do nothing. But prove it. If you don't believe it, now, this is how we try to prove something. We try to see if it's going to work. No, you just do it. You don't try in that sense. You just do it, and then he will manifest himself. Oh, and oh, and oh, and oh, and oh. I've never known anyone that was a faithful tithe that despised tithe. Once you get hooked with this, you hooked. I say you hooked. I've been hooked for 41 years, and I'm hooked. Of every situation, he's proven himself.
Yes.
He's proven himself. Came to Columbus, Georgia with nothing. He proved himself.
Yes.
Came down into Atlanta with nothing. He proved himself. Walked off a job because I felt like it was time to walk away from it. Then the economy flipped and all of a sudden the money got all funny. But you know what? I never missed a house note. I never was late on any bills. It wasn't because I was getting a lot of money. I wasn't getting it from nowhere. But God proved himself. And then remember when I told you that the Lord said, in 2008 I turned the corner on life? Well, it was 2008 and I was still lacking. But the Spirit of the Lord had told me and spoke to me and said, son, you turned the corner on life. And the thing, and I didn't even realize that I had turned the corner on life. And so I looked there and I looked down there and I said, I believe that God told me I had turned the corner on that. And then I could say the Lord spoke to me and said, son, in my faith. Son, in my faith. Son, in my faith. Because when God speaks to you, you may be in a bad condition, but that don't mean that God has lied to you. God spoke to you that word that turned the corner. Long before. Why? Because he lives in one great big eternal now.
Yeah.
As far as God was concerned, I had turned that corner. All I had to do was just keep on walking in. I said, all I had to do, Brad, was just keep on walking in. He said it, and I just kept on walking in. After a while, I started looking up at every bill that was paid. Because I prove it. I prove it. And I keep on proving it.
Yeah.
Keep on proving it. Yeah. Last scripture, we're going home for the day. Then we're going to close next week. We'll deal with supernatural blessings next week. But return to 2 Corinthians. 9th chapter, then we're going home. Okay? This ain't gimmicks. It ain't tricks. It ain't conning nobody. It ain't manipulating nobody. It's taking God at his word and working. Just keep on working. You know what? Because see, I realize Mama taught me so many lessons about things, teaching me things. Things that at the time didn't mean nothing to me. But I see that garden taught me so much.
Yeah.
You need to go plant a garden.
Yeah.
You'll find out. Even if it's a small garden, you'll find out some things when the Bible talks about sowing and reaping and harvest and all that. Because you know what? You find out that the closer you get to harvest, the more you gotta work.
That's it.
The closer, when the things start getting a little tomato, a little more growing and all that, then you gotta really go.
That's it. That's it.
See, we all want to harvest, but we want it without sweat.
That's it.
Ain't no sweat in this harvest. I say, ain't no sweat in this harvest. You gonna have to put your time in, you My baby knew somebody, and they were faithful tithers. They didn't go here, but they were faithful tithers. And he said, I get difficult times. And somebody in the family, one of the family members said, well, stop tithing. You know, God understands. Now, before that person stopped, God was making a way everywhere, every constantly coming through for that person. Over. When they stopped tithing, now they were selling stuff out of their house, trying to make it. Because God can do more with that 90% than you can ever do with it.
That's right.
God can load this table down. See? And stop getting caught up with trying to store stuff. He said he daily loads up with benefit. As long as you got enough for the day, don't worry about tomorrow.
Because
in Jerusalem, The church in Jerusalem was really impoverished because of everything that was going on there. So he had to get an offering from them to help somebody else out. See, sometimes, say it ain't all about you. See, you always want to receive, but you need to learn how good it is just to be the giver.
That's it.
Stop with your hands out. You need to put your hands out to put it in somebody's hand.
That's it.
Third verse. Still, I'm sending the brethren unto you, lest our pride in you should be made an empty boast in this particular case. And so that you may be ready. And I told him, you would be. He said, now, I've been boasting about him. He said, no, don't turn around and make me look bad.
That's right.
He said, I've been telling everybody how great givers you are. Don't turn around and make me ashamed. Let's go to the fourth verse. He said, lest if any Macedonian should come with me and find you unprepared for this generous we to say nothing yourself, be humiliated for our being so confident. That is why I thought it necessary to urge these brethren to go to you before I do and make arrangements in advance for this bountiful promised gift of yours. And listen to this, not as an exhortation. No, as I said, not as an extortion wrung out of you, but as a generous and willing gift. He said, I ain't trying to extort you no money. He said, gotta be generous. Look, remember this. He who sows sparingly and grudgingly also reaps sparingly and grudgingly. And he who sows generously, that the blessing may come to someone, will also reap generously with blessing. Now look at the seventh verse, and we finish here. Let each one give as he has made up his own mind and purposed in his heart, not reluctantly or sorrowful or under compulsion. He said, your giving. Remember I told you about the attitude? Remember I told you about the attitude? Having the right mindset? He says, if you're giving because you feel like somebody has this, because you see it all the time, so many times on Christian television, they make you feel like if you don't do something for them, you won't be blessed.
That's right.
So if I don't wear this particular cloth, I ain't gonna be blessed.
Wow.
So suppose I ain't never turned to your channel. I ain't never seen it. So only the people that seen your channel that bought this cloth from you gonna be blessed with this oil. See, God ain't into no con and no manipulation and all that foolishness. God got principles and a plan. If you follow them, they work. I'm going to finish. He says, for God loves, he takes pleasure in bragging above other things and is unwilling to abandon or to do without a cheerful, joyous, prompt to do it giver, whose heart is in his giving. Your Amplified said, God loves a cheerful giver. So, I would do you a disservice to make you feel bad about giving. Because it wouldn't help you. So, all I'm going to do is what I've done, instruct you. That's it. You have to make up in your mind, he said, their purpose in their heart. You have to make up in your mind whether you're going to obey these principles or not. It's just that simple. You ain't got to fight with me. You got to make up in your mind. Come on, stand to your feet. Next week, we'll be giving the closest out of supernatural blessing that we can see what giving does in any time. But you got to make up in your mind. You got to stop now. You got to get glad about it. You got to be cheerful about it. Whether you're giving your tithe to the church or whether you're blessing somebody, you got to be happy about it. The Lord speak to you to bless somebody. Remember, I said you got to learn to sow and look around. Everybody ain't look around. You can be wasting money, giving it to the wrong people. But if they, God sent to you to bless somebody, you don't get it. Well, I'm going to do it. I really. No, you got to be happy about it. Because God is telling you, if you do what he says and be happy about it, then he's going to bless you. The Bible says, press down, shaking together, and running over. So you gotta make up your mind. And you gotta keep it made up. And you gotta fight. Every time something comes against you, get the weeds out. Every time the weeds come up, you gotta fight them off. Weeds of doubt. Weeds of frustration. Weeds of stinginess, of suffering. I had to keep putting the weeds out of that garden. They would come up every week. And I had to go right back out there. Mama said, dig them up, pull them out, dig them up, pull them out. Why? Because she was looking forward to the harvest of what she had planted. But then you have to be the same way. Dig them out every time they come up. When doubt come up, so now I'm gone. I'm looking for my heart. Pull that weed out. When fear, unbelief, anxiety, that's the weed. You gotta pull them out. So now I'm gonna say I'm gonna trust God. Because God said, he said, if I prove him, he'll open up the window for heaven. Father, in the name of Jesus, pray. I deliver what you have given me, God. I believe I've been faithful to it, what you have instructed me to teach on. Now, Lord, you said your word would return void. So you know who needed it, who needed to hear it. And God, I believe that your word will not return void. It'll strengthen whoever needs strengthened. God knows that I faithfully tithing already, and it seems like God is taking forever for the harvest to come. God, that you will encourage their hearts, because you said, be not weary and well doing. For a new season will be. If we faint not.